please fasten your mental seatbelt because I want to take you on a very fast track and a bumpy road through more than 20 years of European research project experience, hopefully to take off at the end towards 2020 and beyond. In 1992, when Materialize was just created 2 years before, we took on the quite daunting task to start as coordinator of the first research project we were ever involved in. And we started coordinating a project with companies like Siemens, Zeneca, universities like the KU Leuven. At that time, we were only 10 people, very young people, and we had what I would call a mission. The mission was the one of our company that we formulated at the opening reception of our company, that we wanted to contribute to a better and healthier world, and that we believed we could use, well, the technologies we were developing to solve this, to help creating better products. And those technologies were hard and software related to additive manufacturing, of which you have heard already here before. So the program FIDIAS was for us as a company a milestone because it allowed us to start doing structured research and to do it in collaboration with large companies. And the name was chosen because Phidias is the Greek sculptor who sculpted the Parthenon and who was well known to be the first in my aesthetical lessons at high school to be able to really create beautiful human beings in his sculpting. And that's actually what we also wanted to do in the project because we wanted to reproduce pathological situations of people scanned with CT in three-dimensional prints. And, well, when we started the project, what you got out when you printed the voxels or the pixels of a 3D CT at that time was something they like here a lot in Denmark, a Lego-like structure, which was not exactly what a surgeon really found helpful to analyze a situation. So during the project, we developed a lot of technologies. For instance, Siemens perfected spiral CT, which allowed to take the scan of a patient in just a few seconds rather than slice by slice, and made the algorithms to be able to really calculate accurately how this spiral translated in correct 3D information. Materialize did further interpolations on this, KU Leuven worked on that, and that were a lot of technical results. But what was even nicer is that during this project, we continuously did demonstrations to surgeons. So we were quite proud at the end of the project in 1995 that we had supported already during the project, from the project, 70 surgeons on individual people with very complex surgical interventions. And there, for instance, our material development, which resulted in the first colorable 3D printed models, which was done in collaboration with Zeneca, helped to give surgeons instruments to make their surgeries better. And the results demonstrate that nearly in one third of the cases, we could actually remove one of the surgical interventions from the normal healing trajectory. We could, in two thirds of the cases, reduce the surgery time drastically. And in over 80% of the cases, we improved the result of the surgery with approximately 20% results that could never have been obtained in quality without this technology. So you would say, fantastic. Yeah, everybody, I think also the people from the commission, were proud during our final session about this kind of results. And what happened? It was no real success, if you look back. Yeah, it's not that in the following years we could, as a small company, start commercializing, because there was no good ecosystem. In fact, we needed to sell this kind of technology to hospitals where the radiologists were unwilling to give medical images to a company, because medical images was something proprietary to a radiologist. Yeah? Even a surgeon hardly could see them in some hospitals. So this is why innovation didn't work. There was no ecosystem. So at Materialize we thought, well, let's do better. And we created a new project. We called it the PISA project. And in that PISA project, we just didn't create copies of the human anatomy, but we started creating surgical instruments. At least that was something that was being sold, yeah? Not in a lot of sectors, but for instance in the dental sector, and that's why we concentrated first on the dental implantology, oral implantology, where people used already handmade guides that didn't have any information about the patient's anatomy from CT at the moment we started that project. And we created there also multiple examples on patients during the project, and we had a technology ready to go to the market at the end of the project. And actually, we were successful with that technology. Unfortunately, only after we had acquired an American company that was already selling software in the field and that gave us market access. So, being successful with that, in 2006, at once the orthopedic industry, which had laughed at the guide development project in the 90s when it was really happening, because they said, oh, for us it's robot surgery, it's navigation systems that do the job, came back and they got interested in applications like, for instance, knee implant surgery. So at that moment, we started developing, and in a few years' time, we placed in the market systems to guide knee replacement surgery by using exactly the same technology that was developed in the 90s in the PISA project, and where we got funded and collaborated already with some of the players of this industry. So these guides are today, for instance for knees, used by approximately every knee implant company in the world, just 5 years later. So what explains this access to the market at this moment? Well, I will come to that later. But I first want to say that one of the key factors to success is the fact that we created there a product that is a win for the patient, like all the products we created. But in this case, also a win for the surgeon, because he can reduce his surgery time and feel more confident about it. More importantly, it's also a win for the industry, because they can drastically reduce the amount of instrumentation they have to manufacture for each implant being placed. And this is reducing the cost for them. Nevertheless, they are charging guided solutions harder, so they have a good income on this kind of technology at the moment. And for the industry, it's not the only case here, but because for the industry, I more and more count hospitals also among the industry, definitely in the United States. So also for the hospitals, it counts that they can make savings, for instance, because they have to sterilize less instruments. And then finally, through this entire process, by the fact that less implants are going to be needed to be replaced, by the fact that through competition, prices are reducing of those systems, the healthcare systems and the governments will also benefit. In fact, this is how we built our success story, and today half of the activities of Materialize are medical related. We use this technology now at Materialize on a monthly basis to make individual engineering of instruments for more than 5,000 patients per month, which is also a kind of changing ecosystem, because it means that today surgeons are accepting that engineers support them for each individual surgery, which was something which was unheard of when we started our first project in 1992. But on top of that, Materialize developed also a lot of technical capacity. We work a lot with the automotive industry in Europe. We were taking the initiative of the direct spare project, where Siemens has been talking about. So we play also a technological role. And actually, the machines we use most in our facility are the ones we developed in that very first project from Phidias between 92 and 95 to print skulls faster. So at this moment they still print skulls, but they mainly print car parts, all spin-offs from this very first project. As it was said earlier, we have grown, and we have grown every year of our existence to 850 people. So we are definitely proud at Materialize at the way in the way we have been growing, and our people are very proud they can help so many patients around the world. And it are even much more than those 5,000 we help ourselves directly, because more than 400 medical device companies around the world use our technology to create their own devices, sometimes to compete with us in the guide field even. But that's life, and that's healthy. But if I look from the Materialize perspective, the 2.5 million euro that was invested in the Phidias project for all consortium members together, of which Materialize got approximately 1/4, and which we financed 50% ourselves, was a very important amount of money for us, because it had this additional possibility to bring us in contact with large companies and to do research at a different level. On the other hand, if I would be looking at this money from a European Commission perspective, I wouldn't be happy. Because in the end, if this technology is today spreading, it's thanks to US companies, because the entire orthopedic and dental sector is dominated by US companies, and they decide in which European country they are going to use this technology. The revenues that those companies generate on this technology are a multiplicator of what Materialize earns, and a much higher multiplicator of what Materialize pays in taxes. And what is maybe even worse, that is that 80% of the patients that are currently using these technologies are in the US. Not that those people are not allowed to use it, but why are no European citizens using this technology, which clearly on all lines has a very good impact? So while we may be happy with a little bit of funding that we get, I think it's much more important that we use these programs to also, in the meantime, create ecosystems and to have a bigger impact on our politicians and on other aspects of society. So when we go for the takeoff to what we want to do in 2020, I would like to formulate a new project. A new project that hopefully is as influential as the Phidias project was. But at this time, I would take lessons from the past into account. I would like to create again a project with a big added value. And added value means that we translate something that is very good for humanity into economic success. I would like a project that just not cares about creating a technology, but that also cares about creating a market. And I think it needs to have, it needs to be a market with strategic importance, yeah? Not just a new kind of candy, yeah? So these are key factors. And what is then the project that I would like to propose to you? Well, it's a project for which we at Materialize got inspiration from the concern that we have that our products are not getting to a lot of people. Yeah? While they are getting cheaper, they are still not reaching a lot of people. And we took already some initiatives. For instance, during the war in Iraq, we exported our products to Iraq and we created a system to use medical models there in full wartime. But Africa is another country where our technology is today not being used. So we started as Materialize investing as a small company. We knew to focus. We focused on a small, stable country called Benin, which has 4% of the purchasing power parity of Belgium. So people are really poor there. But luckily, this country doesn't have large natural resources. So it's a quite stable country, and there is a limited amount of corruption, not so much more than in Belgium or Germany. So with this, we took a foundation that is working already 30 years in that country, and that was founded by a surgeon from, well, not by a surgeon from Belgium. It was founded because a young surgeon from Belgium and his fiancée, who were doing development work there in the local hospital and the local schools, when they were returning to Belgium, they died because their plane crashed in Africa. So the families of those two young people decided we will continue their work. And they have been doing so for 30 years already. They are administrating two hospitals, four elementary schools. Materialize has committed and is already working to support a secondary school with 2,000 pupils. And we are at the same time helping in the hospitals with our kind of technologies and with the relations we have in the world, for instance, with the American organization SINE, who delivers free implant for fracture care. Because there are a lot of people in Africa that have accidents and nasty accidents. And why do they have those nasty accidents? Because they have no good mobility. The roads are very dangerous, like in a lot of developing countries. And that's where we can create a lot of added value in a market we are currently losing. Because the new truck you saw on the previous slide was a Toyota truck. Yeah? And the other cars you see driving around are those old French cars, 404, 504. Yeah? In this kind of status. Yeah? Because a new car from Europe, you can't drive in Africa. You don't find the petrol that is letting it drive in a good way. So, sorry, this lack of transport is also an impediment to economic growth of this continent. It's a lack of impediment to create a new market because to a large extent, okay, China is now a market, but we all feel that it's clearly dominated by Chinese. Yeah? If we want to create a market that Materialize, that the European Union still can own, it's, for instance, Africa. And we are losing it at the moment. So that's why I want to create a project building European cars, but cars that are really meant for Africa and not for European roads. They must be adapted to the road conditions. They shouldn't drive 200 kilometers an hour because they will never come on German highways. They are sufficient when they drive 90 kilometers an hour at maximum speed, and it will be much safer and much more fuel efficient if they are standardly driving at 50 kilometers an hour. They should not fall in the same trap as the cars we see here on our European roads, that they all carry one person and then not drive but stand still. We rather should have community transport guided by private entrepreneurs that own those small buses. But that means it's not only a project about building those cars, it's also a project about how to finance this. Yeah? Using insurance, for instance, so that financing can happen. It's a challenge not only to the normal industry we have mostly in this room, but also to the banking industry, to the insurance industry. So this should work together with, for instance, support from politics, and not necessarily in monetary terms, rather in political terms, to make sure that those European cars, those European vans, don't get taxed at the border. Because that's the only way how African countries can earn money, because they have poor systems internally. They need to tax at the border, impeding development, impeding their access to good products. So if we build those again with European technology so that we can track where they are driving and that we can build the drivers on a per mileage basis, something we are trying to do here in Europe as well, we can immediately deliver money to the government to make better roads. That's the kind of ecosystem I'm talking about, an ecosystem where also in a second generation, maybe batteries can be placed in the cars because they have, in general, plenty of solar energy. But it can't be the first generation of African cars. I personally absolutely won't support this project if not every car that is going to Africa is paid by an African entrepreneur. It may be financed by a European bank, but it can't be given for free. That's not the way we really support them. It's only by developing local businesses in maintenance of those trucks, in driving those trucks, in fueling those trucks, that we can generate a healthy future. Is this a project for Africa? Yes, it is, but it's as much a project for Europe. Because first, it creates a market for Europe for economic growth. Second, we will have to learn, if we want to be competitive there, to do cost down innovation, at which the Chinese, for instance, are beating us at the moment. Maybe we don't have to assemble the cars here. It can be cheaper done in Africa, but when we maybe have to ship them like IKEA boxes to Africa so that we can concentrate on the high added value components that go into such a car. We should do it also because it doesn't make sense that we are here creating expensive technologies to reduce fuel emissions and so on, and then export our old cars to Africa to ruin the land there. Because we are living on a globe and the air is polluted everywhere. And it's drifting to Europe anyhow. You can see that easily when the Sahara sandstorms are putting dirt on your car. So there will be technological challenges to be solved. For instance, our technology of additive manufacturing could be used to create new types of air filter systems that are maintenance-free, that allow cars also to run in Africa. And it can also be used to create second lives for a number of components. For instance, why would we produce new wheels for those cars in Africa? We have plenty of wheels we are simply throwing away. at this moment in Europe. And while recycling is, of course, already much better than throwing it away in a dump field, it's even costing less energy when we simply reuse all those wheels, of which a majority is still very well usable when we dispose of our old car. So I want to bring this together now. And what I want to say is that we need to build this ecosystem. And the competitive advantage that Europe will have is that it controls the ecosystem, just like Apple controls the world by controlling its own ecosystem. If we do it working together between the different kinds of industries and with the politicians. Because, again, this is not a project for the industrial sector. It's as much for the financial sector. It's as much for the insurance sector. It's for the accounting sector to show clearly that there is no money disappearing in this project. It's for the media sector. I want to challenge the media to report on this project, not by creating a few scandals and then next week tell about another scandal, but to consistently create a positive outcome and collaboration for all of the parties involved from now until 2020. That's a big challenge for the media industry. And of course, our politicians, because they will need to guide this all. And now I would like to close, Mr. Chairman, by proposing something different. Rather than you asking me questions, I'm going to ask you a few questions. So, my first question, who has been reading all of the text around the flagship areas for 2020? Who in this room? Sorry, but a flag, wasn't that something to run behind, to believe in? So if you haven't been reading this text, oh, two persons here in the front, congratulations. I tried to read it, I didn't get to the end. So who believes this text really engages? I think the answer is simple. I don't have to ask it even, yeah? So who believes now that a project like African Drive could engage a lot of people, could really create interest in what European technologies can do, could really create young engineers or young people, 15-year-olds, that start thinking about becoming an engineer, becoming a scientist who solves these problems for the world. Who in this room would like to be in such a project? Thank you very much.